to another light. No more sorrow and no more night. You're the light, let it shine now. Let it shine now. Burning bright, cause we're not ashamed. Got a world to illuminate. You're the light, let it shine now. Let it shine now.
Can't hardly wait to share with you. I'm so excited about the word I've got for you today. And get a Bible in your hand and get ready to follow in scripture. Make some notes there and let's enjoy this message today and just it's a blessing. I want to start by reading the Easter story. Just start reading in Matthew chapter 28, verse 1 through 9. I'm going to read it here. This Easter story from, oops, sorry about that. I pulled my pulpit up and it squeaked. Matthew chapter 28 and verse 1 through 9. Oh, are you ready? Are you ready? Amen. Let's go ahead and get started here today. Matthew 28 verse 1 through 9. Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. I need to read on, but I just have to tell you. This grave was so defeated that the thing that sealed it, an angel sat on it. Glory be to God. His countenance, this is the angel, was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And the guard shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen. As he said, come, he is not here, for he is risen as he said. Come and see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and indeed he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them saying, "Rejoice." Amen. So they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. You gotta love somebody like that. You gotta worship somebody like that. When you see a revelation of the risen Lord, it brings worship. They held him by his feet and they worshiped him. God, I thank you today. This story is real. It's true. It's undisputed except by fake media of that day. We know there were eyewitnesses and the truth couldn't be disputed that Jesus had risen from the dead. Wow. Just like these two women who met him on that road to tell the other disciples. What a privilege these women had to be the first to see Jesus, to discover that he had risen, and to be the messengers of the resurrection. Whew! God. Then they took him by the feet and they worshiped him. It would make us worship him. It does make us worship him. Hallelujah. Nail-scarred hands, nail-scarred feet. He is risen from the dead, and we worship him. Jesus, we worship you. We praise you, and we give you glory. This story is too good to be true, but it's true. We worship you, and we glorify your name. Hallelujah. Let every word be a word from you today, as much as you can do that through this vessel. Let every word we speak, and help me to speak it like I should, and help us to hear it the way we should, and let Jesus be magnified, so that at the end of this message and the end of this service, it would practically be as though we were those two women who are looking at Jesus, and we would worship him. In Jesus' name, I pray over this message, over this service. In hallelujah. Amen and amen. Oh, wipe your tears there with me for a second here before I get started. Woo! Praise you, God. Praise you, God. They worshiped him. John chapter 2, verse 22. This is now after, of course, the resurrection. And it says, when he had risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this to them. And they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had said. After they saw Jesus and he had risen from the dead, it says they believed the things he had said about this, and they believed scripture. I want to tell you today in 2020 that the resurrected Jesus is the reason we should believe scripture. It's the reason we should believe the words of scripture. It's the reason we should believe the words he spoke. The resurrection of Jesus ought to be the greatest news across the planet every day that this planet wakes up to a new dawn, because it's the greatest news. It's the dividing point of history. It is a fact that he rose from the dead. Friend, it ought to be proof, undisputable proof, and it should settle the issue once and for all. Believe scripture and believe what he says. Yes. Because he said he would rise from the dead. He said he would tear down that temple and build it again in 3 days, and he did it. And of course, a story went out, because quickly they wanted to try to hide it, the authorities of that day. And they said, quickly, go out and print in the newspapers and get the word out that his disciples stole his body and carried him away, so that this would be some kind of, you know, I'll tell you, the original fake news happened right there when Jesus rose from the dead. Because they quickly conspired to put out a fake story. But that story can't hold any water, because Jesus appeared to thousands of people, hundreds at a time. Hundreds at a time, and thousands of people, and people even saw him go back to glory. So listen, it's undisputable. And the fact that it's undisputable and he rose from the dead means we got to believe him. Just like those early disciples, now they believe what he said, and they believe scripture. They believe scripture. Romans chapter 1, verse 4. Then we'll get to what I want to do today in this message. Romans 1 verse 4, he was declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. Wow. I mean, you got to believe what he said because he rose from the dead. And that resurrection from the dead declared that he is who he said he is. He is the Son of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Two more verses from 1 Corinthians 15, verse 14. 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 14. Paul comes along and he talks a lot about the resurrection, and this is what he says here about it. If Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and our faith is also empty. But thank God, Paul, he is risen. Our preaching isn't empty. It's full of the power of a resurrected Jesus. And our faith isn't empty. Our faith is met by the power of a resurrected Lord who overcame all that was against us for us. And when we believe him, all of that comes toward us and we are born again. Our preaching is with the power of a resurrected Lord, and our faith meets that power to make it real in our life. Glory be to God. And then 1 Corinthians 15, verse 17, same passage, Paul says, if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile and you're still in your sins. If he isn't risen, we're in trouble. But we're not in trouble. Glory. We're not in trouble because Jesus rose from the dead. And what was accomplished up to that resurrection, it worked. It worked. That's the title of my message today. It worked. The resurrection, folks, is proof that what Jesus did on Calvary in his death, in his suffering, in him giving himself as the Lamb of God, in him being broken, the bread of life for us, his wounds, his stripes healing us, it worked. And the resurrection is proof that it worked. So here's the title of my sermon. That's the title of my sermon. It worked. It worked. It worked. Jesus said he had come to do a work. He said, I got to come do what the Father sent me to do. I am here with a purpose. And especially as I told you last week and at the Good Friday communion service, as Jesus went up to Jerusalem riding that donkey and he was going up there, it seemed that it was at that point that he began to focus on this redemptive work that he had been sent to earth to do. And now he's going to Jerusalem. He's going there with the Old Testament prophet said his face was set like flint to Jerusalem. He's going to the seat of authority to do his work. He's going to go there and accomplish what he was born here to do. He is here to do something. And the resurrection, friend, is the seal, it's the proof, it's the evidence that what he came here to do, it worked. Yeah. And I'll tell you why we say it worked by the resurrection. I'll show you in just a moment. Look at John chapter 1, verse 29. Oh, I hope you take some notes. I got three things that I want to tell you that worked and why he rose from the dead. Because it worked. John chapter 1 verse 29. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. When Jesus hung on that cross, he said those famous words that really are the foundation of so much of the grace message that we preach. It is finished. If you don't remember what it was, go back and we'll post up the message from Friday night and let you know what was finished. Don't have time to go through them now, but what he came to accomplish, he finished it. Yeah. It is finished. And so complete, he finished it so completely that the effect of that problem, the problem of sin, couldn't keep its hold on him anymore, that by the time Sunday morning came, he rose from the dead. Because think about it like this with me. That's why this message, it worked, is because if he hadn't eradicated all of sin and its effect, then the original sin, which said, if you do this, you will surely die, then he could not have raised from the dead. Death would have kept its grip on him because he identified completely with us. He identified completely with our sin. So in his resurrection, it means he must have dealt with all that sin and every problem of humanity that he took on himself. He must have cleared it out of the way completely, because just one little part of that still having a hold on him would not have allowed him to raise from the dead. But because it was gone, a new Adam could be born and a new birth be brought. Oh my God. Hallelujah. Yeah. He was raised from the dead. Acts chapter 2 verse 24. Whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death. I love this next phrase, because it was not possible that he should be held by it. Now, the reason he couldn't be held by it is because he did something about it. What held people in chains of bondage to sin, slavery, separation from God, he did something about it, eradicated those chains, that sin and that problem, so much so that the pains of that death and that problem couldn't hold him anymore, and he came out of that grave. Yeah. Hallelujah. Jesus is alive. Death has lost its victory, and the grave has been denied. Jesus is alive. Glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Jesus is alive. The work that he did, what did he do that worked? Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2 through 3. Hebrews 1, verse 2 through 3, and it says, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Whew. Well, here's the first thing that worked. He purged our sins. Already talked about it, but it worked. It worked. Because what he took of our sin couldn't keep him in the grave. I've already described it to you, but let's just say it again. He so eradicated the sin problem that not one effect of sin could keep its deadly grip on him. And he rose from the dead by a miracle of God, because he dealt with our sin. Hallelujah. Oh, he purged our sins. Hebrews 2 verse 14 says, inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. So he eradicated the sin problem. Sin couldn't hold him anymore. And by doing so, he destroyed the power of death. He destroyed the power of death. That death that began with the original sin, Adam and Eve's sin. Jesus suffered the consequences for it. Took the problem. Suffered for it. Oh, we watched this movie, The Passion of the Christ, the other night, and it's so hard to watch. So hard to watch, and probably doesn't even come close to telling the whole story, but he suffered so. But in his suffering, in his body, in his soul, and in his spirit, and all that Jesus suffered, somehow that was the penalty. Somehow that was the manifestation of the death that was spoken in Genesis when it said, the day you eat of that tree, you'll die. Paul said death reigned through this period. Jesus suffered this penalty, took this death, and so defeated it. Apparently his work so defeated this, destroyed the power of death, that it just couldn't hold him anymore. And the grave had to open, and a resurrected Jesus walked out of that tomb. Because he destroyed the power of death. He came out of that tomb because it worked. What he did in redemption for us, what he suffered for us, what he took upon himself, it worked. And it worked completely. So much so that he came out of that tomb because it worked. Glory be to God. Yeah. He took that death. We know it because when he was on that cross and he was ready to give up his breath, he cried out these most agonizing words. The eternal Son of God said, my God, why have you forsaken me? My God, why have you forsaken me? He was separated from God. The most horrible consequence of sin. But what he did in that separation and identifying with us so eradicated the power of death. It worked. It cleared it out until Jesus rose from the dead and the resurrected Lord said, I have the keys of death, hell, and the grave. Yes. Glory, hallelujah. Now we are raised with him as children of God. And because he took that penalty, because he took that separation on our behalf, now we are raised as children of God. And Jesus said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. We can never and will never have to say, my God, why have you forsaken us? Because Jesus made peace, which means bring the two of us together. Yes. Yes. Hallelujah. The book of Hebrews says eternal peace brought us together forever. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, God. We are children of God because it worked. It worked. The plan of redemption worked. And it worked because Jesus rose from the dead, victorious over everything he came to remove and take care of us and take care for us on our behalf. Yeah, yes. Oh, glory, hallelujah. You got it? He purged us from our sins. He destroyed the power of death. And there's a third thing Scripture is clear he took care of on the cross and finished for us. Colossians chapter 2, verse 14. Colossians 2, verse 14. Hey, whoo, I tell you, if you're having fits of excitement there at your house or wherever you are, I'm not responsible for it. Well, maybe I am. But I'll tell you right now, whew, this stuff can get you fired up. What a Jesus. What a Savior. Colossians 2, verse 14, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, he took it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. Yeah, the third thing that worked was he cleared out the checklist against us. He cleared the checklist. It doesn't get any more clear than this, that he took the handwriting, or we could say the checklist. He took the law. He took the things against us. Everything, every tongue that condemned us, everything that had a saying in our condemnation, everything that could be taken to court against us, Jesus took it to the cross, nailed it there, and took it out of the way for us. Look at this same verse in the Message translation of the Bible. Look at this. The Message translation of Colossians 2, verse 14. The slate wiped clean. That old arrest warrant canceled and nailed to Christ's cross. Hallelujah. Old arrest warrant is canceled and it's nailed to the cross. Everything, anything, our own problem, the law, the original sin. You want to go through whatever the list is, you can just keep going through it. The devil's condemnation, anything. It doesn't matter what you want to put on that checklist that was against us. Jesus carried it in his body to the tree, nailed it to the cross, and it died with him. If one thing could have still been held against us, against us, because everything he went to the cross with and for was with our problem and for us. So if anything could have still been checked off against us, Jesus couldn't have risen from the dead, because it would have still been held against him, because he became us and our sin. And if it hadn't have worked, he'd still be in the grave. But it worked. And he rose from the dead. Hallelujah. Just one thing that would have still had a hold or could accuse us, and he'd still be in the grave. But it worked. It worked. And everything, the whole list, was nailed to the cross. And it worked. It died with him. Its penalty was paid. Salvation and redemption was satisfied. The word redemption's the best one to use. It was a purchase, it was a price. He paid the price. He did the work of redemption. He did it. It worked. And the resurrection is proof that it worked, because this man, Jesus, took care of all our problem, and he rose from the dead. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It purged our sin. Purged our sin. So if he didn't completely get it out of the way, he'd still be in the grave. If death could have any hold on us at all, he'd still be in the grave. But it worked. Oh, if any voice against us, original sin, the law, our own failure, Man's problem could still be used as a checklist against us. He'd still be in the grave. But it worked. And he rose from the dead, victorious over it all, victorious over all of it for us. And friend, that resurrection was proof that the redemptive work of Christ paid the price, did what he came to do, did the job, it worked, and now we can by faith obtain our salvation. Everything is saved, healed, whole, made right. We have peace with God. Our sins are gone. We're alive in Christ Jesus. We are filled with the Holy Spirit. We're empowered by him. We live in the power of his resurrection. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead quickens our mortal body. We are filled with God himself. He said, I'll come and make my home in you. We are temples. We are vessels. We are houses of God. God lives in us. He and us have become one. We have been brought together by eternal peace through our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That's what God did for us. He rose from the dead. We have risen to a new life. We are seated with Christ in heavenly places, far above anything that could condemn us, principalities and powers, any enemy that comes against us. We are seated with Christ in heavenly places, and here we are, risen with Christ. Yeah, we were buried, Romans 6 says, we were buried in baptism into his death. That's right, we died with him. We died with him. This work of redemption was all accomplished as if it were us paying the price for our problem. It was as if we had nailed the handwriting of requirements to the cross because he went for us. It was as though we had been judged for our sin. It was as though we had taken the penalty of this problem. But because he took it for us, the vicarious work of Jesus. He is our vicar, one who does it on our behalf. He did it for us. Drank that cup on our behalf. And it worked because he cleared the cup and offers us not the cup of condemnation he drank in the garden, but offers us the cup of fellowship with all the blessing. Is this not the cup of blessing which we drink, Paul said? It's a cup filled with what God has provided for us in Christ Jesus. We are now partakers of the divine nature because Jesus was a partaker of the human nature. Oh my goodness. How am I ever going to finish here today? This just messes me up. Oh, don't you just want to tell the whole world? Don't you just want to tell everybody what Jesus did? What a Savior, what a Lord. It just, you know, you think about these things and you look at this revelation and you go, can this really be a true story? Oh, it's so true. It's so true. And hey, Jesus, what he did, it worked. It worked. And it was finished. Let's go to a final verse. And oh, I tell you, are you ready? Are you ready just to rejoice? Hebrews 12, verse 2. I wish we had all. Well, I guess we do have all day. I guess we did. What are we in a hurry for? I mean, we're quarantined, right? Lock the doors, Charlie. Let's go. That's right. All right. Well, this broadcast is going to go for another 3 hours, folks. Just teasing. I'd like to take you to Bible school and teach you the book of Romans and the book of Hebrews and how that Paul started out the book of Romans, Romans 1, starting out saying the resurrection of Jesus is proof of who he is. I read the verse earlier, but then Paul goes all throughout the book of Romans to teach us the message of grace. But he starts the book out with the resurrection. And then the writer of Hebrews, which many think was Paul, we don't know for sure, but whoever wrote the book of Hebrews starts out the book of Hebrews with, this is Jesus, the final revelation. He is the one who came, the express image of God. Jesus came, and then he lays the case that everything the old pointed to was Jesus. And Jesus is now the antitype, which means he's now the substance of all the types and shadows. He's the real thing. And now we can believe in Jesus because he took away and fulfilled the old. And Jesus is now the one we believe in. And he teaches the whole book of Hebrews based on who Jesus is and the resurrection from the dead. Hallelujah. And then in the book of Acts, the early church, they argued that the big thing was the resurrection from the dead. And they were talking about our resurrection a lot. But Peter's first sermon, Acts chapter 2, the first sermon of the newborn church was about the resurrection. He rose from the dead. This Jesus whom you crucified, he's now risen from the dead, and God has exalted him on high and made him king. Hallelujah. And now the church is birthed, and they go out, and it says with great power they gave witness to the resurrection. Oh, the resurrection, the Jesus rising from the dead. This week as I studied for this sermon and just meditated in these truths and read the stories of the resurrection, I realized this really is. I know you knew this already, but I'll tell you, it was like so fresh to me this week. This really is what makes Christianity different than anything else. Christianity isn't a religion. It is the way. The truth, because behind it is the founder, Jesus, one who was dead, but now he is alive. Amen. So it just kind of takes argument away for me and made me realize, wow, we got a story to tell. Hey, Hebrews 12, verse 2. Hebrews 12, verse 2. And well, then, with all that in mind, Paul, whoever wrote the book of Hebrews, said, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Hey, if you want to look at that scripture, I want to go through a couple words in it right here. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Looking unto, English language, man, I tell you, it sure doesn't do justice to how these scriptures were written in their original language. So that's why we dig in and look. This word looking has so much theology and so much New Testament truth in it. So let me set the background one more time. So the writer of Hebrews is disconnecting us from everything old, old sacrifices, old systems, old priesthoods, and is connecting us to Jesus. And the first verse of Hebrews 11 says, now faith is the substance of these things. We believe, and Jesus is the substance of everything we need. Then here he comes and says, looking unto Jesus. That word looking means to look away and look up to something higher. So it would be like if I were looking here at my notes here and I'm kind of looking down, looking at this and my focus is on this. The word looking there means look away from that. Get your eyes off of that and look, lift your eyes up because there's something higher to look at. Mm-hmm. Woo! Glory, hallelujah. All the old has been fulfilled in Jesus. Jesus is here. Look now, get your eyes off of that and get your eyes on Jesus, because it's something higher to look at than what you've been focusing on. Looking unto Jesus. Well, that's the word repentance. Repentance means to turn away from something, to turn to something else. Repent and think differently. Repent and believe differently. Repent, look away from anything else for your security, and look to Jesus. It's someone, something higher to look at and look to than anything you've ever been looking to and looking at. Looking unto Jesus, the author. Yeah, that's right, the author. That's the word archegos, which means the captain of our salvation. He took us there, where we needed to go to clear our sin, where we needed to go to be free from death, where we needed to go to pay the price, where we needed to go to be forgiven, to have our sins purged, where we needed to go to be children of God, where we needed to go to never be separated from God again. Jesus took us there. He's the captain of this boat. He's the captain of this journey. He took us to the cross and finished the work. He's the captain of our salvation. And look to Jesus. Come on. Get your gaze on someone, something higher than anything else. Because He's the captain. He took us there. And it worked. Because He finished the work. He's the finisher. The completeness of this work. If anything had been left undone, death would have been able to hold Him. But because He's the finisher, it is finished. He completed it. Not one jot or tittle. That's an old King James words. Not one crossing of the T, or not one dotting of the I, of what had to be fulfilled, He said, is going to slip away. It's all going to be fulfilled. He completed it to every crossing of the T, to every dotting of the I. Because if just one dot of an I had been left undone, it would scream in judgment against Him, against us, and He'd still be in the grave. But He accomplished every letter, every dotting of the I. He finished the work. So that not one voice can rise against Him. And He rose from the dead. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Jesus cleared the problem so that there could be a new birth. He became sin for us so that we can be made the righteousness of God. He died. And His death accomplished everything so completely that Jesus, who was dead with the sin and trespass, the problem of all humanity, couldn't be held by that problem anymore because He completely eradicated it. Look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Father, we thank You. We praise You. Thank You, Father. This Easter Sunday. Thank You, Father. What a work. What a plan. You, the Godhead, planned this before the foundations of the world. It was a story written. Like people write a novel today and then make a movie to illustrate the novel. You wrote this plan in eternity past, created man, and the movie came to life. And what You had written and determined in Your heart became real. The object of your love was born in that garden, the Garden of Eden. The object of your love was cleansed and purified in another garden, the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus took that cup. And then the consummation, the fullness of our redemption and your plan in the new birth of Jesus was born in another garden, the garden tomb, where that rich man's tomb was borrowed for those few days, and then Jesus rose from the dead. Father, what a plan. That whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Resurrected Jesus. I ask every person, every young person, child, doesn't matter what your age is, that included everyone, didn't it? Young person and child. Everyone can say amen. And that's all of us. Every person can lift our eyes to Jesus. Please do it now. I'm sure you already have. You couldn't hear a message like this and not already have gone, Jesus. That cry from your heart's already saved you. Because we believe in him, and whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. It's about believing in him and putting our hearts cry out to him that we trust him. We trust what you did because you rose from the dead. We believe you and we believe scripture.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So let's together right now just say it together. I put all my faith, all my trust in Jesus. For my life and eternity. In Jesus' name, I'm saved. Amen. Hey, let us know you want to be baptized and you want to follow Christ. And oh, welcome to this new life in Christ. We are risen from the dead. Because if we were buried with him in death, we also rose with him. Amen.